In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. My dear brothers and sisters, love grows where trust is laid, and love dies where trust is betrayed. So today we are celebrating the feast of Saint Alphonsa, an Indian saint, and she was able to love God all throughout of her life. In the same way, we each one of us are also called to love God and to remain faithful in our call. Now to participate more worthily in this Holy Eucharist, let us acknowledge that we are sinners and ask the Lord for pardon and forgiveness. I confess to Almighty God and to you, my brothers and sisters, that I have greatly sinned in my thoughts and in my words, in what I have done and in what I have failed to do, through my most grievous fault. Therefore, I ask Blessed Mary, ever Virgin, all the angels and saints, and you, my brothers and sisters, to pray for me to the Lord our God. May Almighty God have mercy on us, forgive us our sins, and bring us to everlasting life. Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Let us pray. Hear us, God, our Savior, that as we rejoice in commemorating the Virgin Blessed Alphonsa, we may be instructed by her loving devotion through our Lord Jesus Christ, your Son, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
The law was given through Moses. First reading, a reading from the book of Exodus, chapter 20, verses 1 to 17. The Lord spoke all these words. He said, I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery. You shall have no gods except me. You shall not make yourself a carved image or any likeness of anything in heaven or earth beneath or in the waters under the earth. You shall not bow down to them or serve them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, and I punish the father's fault in the sons, the grandsons, and the great-grandsons of those who hate me. But I show kindness to thousands of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not utter the name of the Lord your God to misuse it, for the Lord will not leave unpunished the man who utters his name to misuse it. Remember the Sabbath day and keep it holy. For 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath for the Lord your God. You shall do no work that day, neither you nor your son, nor your daughter, nor your servants, men or women, nor your animals, nor stranger who lives with you. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth and the sea and all that these hold. But on the seventh day he rested. That is why the Lord has blessed the Sabbath day and made it sacred. Honor your father and your mother so that you may have a long life in the land that the Lord your God has given you. You shall not kill. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his servant, man or woman, or his ox, or his donkey, or anything that is his. The word of the Lord. Response: Lord, you heard the message of eternal life. The law of the Lord is perfect. It revives the soul. The rule of the Lord is to be trusted. It gives wisdom to the simple. Response: The precepts of the Lord are right. They gladden the heart. The command of the Lord is clear. It gives light to the eyes. Response: The fear of the Lord is holy, abiding forever. The decrees of the Lord are truth, and all of them just. Response: They are more to be desired than gold, than the purest of gold, and sweeter are they than honey from the comb. Response: Gospel acclamation. Accept and submit to the word which has been planted in you and can save your souls.
The Lord be with you. A reading from the Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew. Chapter 13, verses from 18 to 23. Jesus said to his disciples, "You are to hear the parable of the sower. When anyone hears the word of the kingdom without understanding, the evil one comes and carries off what was sown in his heart. This is the man who received the seed on the edge of the path. The one who received it on patches of rock is the man who hears the word and welcomes it at once with joy. But he has no root in him. He does not last. Let some trial come, or some persecution on account of the word, and he falls away at once. The one who received the seed in thorns is the man who hears the word, but the worries of this world and the lure of riches choke the word, and so he produces nothing. And the one who receives the seed in rich soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. He is the one who yields a harvest and produces now a hundredfold, now 60, now 30. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise the Lord. May these words of the gospel wipe away our sins from us. My dear brothers and sisters, today's gospel reading is speaking about the kingdom of God. If the kingdom of God is not your first choice, it does not matter what is your second choice. If the kingdom of God is not our first choice, it does not matter what is our second choice. The kingdom of God is available for you and for me here and now. But the question is, are you available to the kingdom or not? We need to ask, my dear brothers and sisters. Today's first reading, if you have listened carefully, it is speaking about the Ten Commandments. If God would have wanted us to live in a permissive society, He would have given us 10 suggestions rather than 10 commandments. God did not give us 10 suggestions, but God gave us the 10 commandments in order to be followed and in order to be lived, my dear brothers and sisters. So to simplify, I think we all have remembered and we all know the 10 commandments. Maybe when we are children, during the catechism class, we have learned, I think. So in order to simplify those 10 commandments, God's top 10, the first commandment is speaking, put God first. Second commandment is saying, worship Him only. The third commandment is saying, no bad words. The fourth commandment is saying, work 6 days and rest 1 day. The fifth commandment is saying, obey your parents. The sixth commandment is saying, harm no one. The seventh commandment is saying, don't cheat. Eighth commandment is saying, if it is not yours, don't take it. The ninth commandment is saying, tell the truth always. And tenth commandment is saying, don't be jealous about other people's stuff. So my dear brothers and sisters, these are the 10 commandments. And these are not the 10 suggestions. We need to follow. We have to follow. And we must follow if you and I want to be the child of God, my dear brothers and sisters. The 10 commandments are teaching us 4 lessons at least. The 10 commandments teach us that our relationship with God is of primary importance. The 10 commandments is teaching us that our relationship with others is of secondary importance. The 10 commandments is teaching us that our relationship with God is conditional. The 10 commandments is pointing us towards Christ. Why it is pointing towards Christ? Because the law that we have, it does not help us. It leaves us helpless. The law that we have does not justify us. It leaves us guilty. The law that we have does not grace us. It leaves us merciless. The law that we have exposes our sins. Consequently, the law reveals our desperate need for something that we do not have and cannot obtain by our works. That is the righteousness in the eyes of God. The righteousness can only be attained or can only be received by having the faith in Jesus Christ. It is not the law, it is not the commandments that is going to save you and save me, but it is the grace of God, and the grace of God, and through to have the faith in Jesus Christ, we are able to receive the righteousness in the eyes of God, my dear brothers and sisters. Coming to the gospel. Today's gospel reading is taken from the gospel of Matthew, chapter 13. Chapter 13 of Matthew has 8 parables, not one parable, 8 parables. The first parable is the sower of the soils, which is 13th chapter from verse 1 to 9. And from verses 10 to 17, we see the reason why Jesus was speaking in the parables. And today's gospel is taken from verse 18 to 23rd, which gives an explanation of the first parable. The second parable in the gospel of Matthew chapter 13 we have is the parable of the weeds. The third one is the mustard seed. The fourth one is the leavens. The fifth one is the hidden treasure. The sixth one is the costly pearl. The seventh one is the net. And the eighth one is the householder. So the gospel of Matthew chapter 13 is full of parables. Eight parables. And if you notice very carefully among these eight parables, six parables, they start with the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like this. Six parables starting with the phrase, the kingdom of God is like. The first parable and the last parable does not start with the phrase, the kingdom of heaven is like this. But yet, the first parable and also the last parable is also speaking about the kingdom, my dear brothers and sisters. So in today's gospel, we have the explanation. We have the explanation of the first parable, that is the sower of the soils. What is the seed? And who is the sower? And what is the field? Jesus is giving us an explanation. What is the seed? The seed sown here is the word of God, my dear brothers and sisters. It comes from heaven and it leads us to heaven. It comes from the King of Kings, and therefore we must subject ourselves to it and ruled by it. Once an old Gujarati Adivasi was living alone, and he wrote a letter that he wanted to grow his groundnut field, but he could not because his only son was put in the jail. So he sought the help of the serpent in order to write the letter, and he wrote the letter to his son who was in jail. My dear son, this year I am not able to cultivate the groundnut field because you are not here to help me to flow the land. And immediately he got the reply from his son, Papa, please don't dig the field because I have buried my weapons there. And the next day, a group of policemen came to the field with the tractors and dug the whole field, but unfortunately they could not find any weapons there. This old man was shocked and he wrote a letter back to his son. What had happened? That the policeman came with the tractors and dug the whole field. Then his son told, Papa, go ahead and now plant the groundnuts. This is the best that I could do from my prison. This is the best that I could do from my prison. So my dear brothers and sisters, the words of this son can make wonders, can make miracles. So the seed that is sown is the word of God. Through the word of God, lot of miracles will happen. In the same way, whatever the words that you speak also, you and I must be able to speak the positive words, which gives an energy to the others, not the negative words. We should not be the pessimistic people and negative minded people, talking always about the others, criticizing the others, criticizing the church. So how are our words? What kind of words are you planting here on this earth, my dear brothers and sisters? The second one is, who is the sower? The sower is the Jesus himself. It is the Lord Jesus Christ himself who sows the seed, either personally or through his ministers. The ministers are the laborers in the vineyard of God. And the gospel preached by them is not their words, but they are the words of the kingdom which gives you life, my dear brothers and sisters. The third explanation is the field. The field is the heart of the man. The human heart is the field where the word of the kingdom is sown, and it produces fruits depends upon the nature of the heart you have. If the heart is well disposed, then the harvest is plentiful. And if your heart is ill disposed, then the seeds wither and die. It all depends on what kind of heart you are having. If your heart is well disposed, the harvest is plentiful. And if your heart is ill disposed, then the seeds that is sown by Jesus Christ will wither and will die, my dear brothers and sisters. One day, a parish priest in one of the big shrine, so he was the main celebrant, and he was celebrating the mass. He read the gospel. After reading the gospel, all the people sat there to listen to his homily, and they had seen an incident which they had never seen in their life. What this parish priest did during the homily time, without preaching, he opened his shaving kit and started to shave his beard. All the people were dumbstruck, and there was pin drop of silence. After 10 minutes, the usual time of the homily in the mass, he removed that and he started the mass as usual with the offertory rite. He continued the mass as usually, and the people left the church shocked. The next Sunday, the whole church was packed. So many people had turned to the church, and the parish priest again was the main celebrant. He read the gospel, and people sat there to see what is going to happen, whether the parish priest is going to shave his beard again or shave his head. So all the people sat there, and now the parish priest started to speak to them. Only last Sunday, my dear brothers and sisters, in my lifetime, I have used my time fruitfully. He said, only last Sunday, in my whole lifetime, I have used my time fruitfully. Instead of preaching the word of God for you, which I consider a mere waste of time in my life. And to my surprise, I have seen and I have received the reactions from the different quarters of our people. The first reaction I got from the bishop, he said, bishop rang me up and inquired whether I am keeping well. My sister and my brother-in-law had come from our native place to inquire whether I am keeping well. The Legion of Mary members, they have started the chain rosary for me. And the charismatic group has sat in 24 hours adoration. And our parish council had a secret meeting how to go about this case. And our youth people, they have already consulted the mental hospital for an admission for me. And today they have invited the media persons to take the live mass, that what I am going to preach or what I am going to do at the altar. So, my dear friends, every Sunday, here, the seeds, the word of God is sown from the altar, but I don't feel that it is bearing the fruits. Most of the time, those seeds which are sown from the altar are fall on the path and fall on the rock. If at all you have used the 10% of your energy which you have used about the last Sunday's incident, our church would not have been like this, and our lives would not have been like this. So, my dear brothers and sisters, use some energy. Listen to the word of God. Take it to the heart. Meditate it and live it in your life. And he concluded the mass. All the people went home remembering about the parable of the sower and the seed. My dear brothers and sisters, we come regularly. We listen to the mass. We say we are the senior parishioners. We have been here 30, 40 years onwards. We listen to the word of God, but no fruits. If at all those fruits are there, they are the rotten fruits. How are we? How are we listening to the word of God? The seed that is sown is planted by Jesus Christ himself. And how is your heart? Your heart is the field. And if your heart is well disposed, it will bear fruit, nice fruits. And if your heart is ill disposed, you will bear rotten fruits, my dear brothers and sisters. What lessons we can learn? The first one is, we need to sow this word. There will be results. Some will reject, some will accept and bear the fruits. But our duty is to sow the seeds, to sow the seeds and to preach the word of God. Second thing is, people need to have an open heart to receive the word. We don't want to be like the man in the book of James that looks in the mirror and does not notice the things that need fixing. Why we see the mirror early morning? Why we see the mirror? In order to see whether our hair is proper, our dress is proper, our face is proper. But the man who hears the word of God and does not understand it is the one who looks into the mirror but does not notice what needs to be fixed. Are we like that? When we listen to the word of God, we need to see ourselves what needs to be fixed, what needs to be corrected. We need to fix it and we need to correct it, my dear brothers and sisters. Today, your greatest contribution to the kingdom of God may not be something that you do, but someone you raise. It may be one of your children. It may be one of your family members, someone you raise. There can be no kingdom of God in the world without the kingdom of God in your hearts, my dear brothers and sisters. So first and foremost, have the kingdom of God in your heart and the kingdom of God will come into the society. Pray, my dear brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Almighty Father. As we proclaim your wonders, O Lord, in the virgin blessed Alphonsa, we humbly implore your majesty that as her merits are pleasing to you, so too our dutiful service may find favor in your sight. Through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father most holy, through your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, your word through whom you made all things, whom you sent as our Savior and Redeemer, incarnate by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin, fulfilling your will and gaining for you a holy people, he stretched out his hands as he endured his passion, so as to break the bonds of death and manifest the resurrection. And so with the angels and all the saints, we declare your glory as with one voice we acclaim, God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. You are indeed holy, O Lord, the fount of all holiness. Make holy, therefore, these gifts, we pray, by sending down your Spirit upon them like the dewfall, so that they may become for us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. At the time he was betrayed and entered willingly into his passion, he took bread and, giving thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body, which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and once more giving thanks, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. When we eat this bread and drink this cup, we proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. Therefore, as we celebrate the memorial of his death and resurrection, we offer you, Lord, the bread of life and the chalice of salvation, giving thanks that you have held us worthy to be in your presence and minister to you. Humbly we pray that, partaking of the body and bread of Christ, we may be gathered into one by the Holy Spirit. Remember, Lord, your church spread throughout the world, and bring her to the fullness of charity, together with Francis our Pope, and Tumabala our Archbishop, and all the clergy. Remember also our brothers and sisters who have fallen asleep in the hope of the resurrection. In a special way, we remember and pray for all the departed souls in our families, brothers and sisters, parents, our beloved ones. Very specially, we remember and pray for the departed soul of Sagaya Nathan, Raj and Jude Mark Matthew and his grandparents, Shiv Reddy, K. Raja Reddy. Welcome them into the light of your face. Have mercy on us all, we pray, that with the Blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, Saint Joseph, our spouse, with the blessed apostles and all the saints, Saint Alphonsa, Saint Anthony, who have pleased you throughout the ages, we may merit to be co-heirs to eternal life, and may praise and glorify you through your Son, Jesus Christ. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, Almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours forever and ever. Let us pray with confidence to the Father in the words our Savior taught us. Our Father,
Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope and the coming of our Savior Jesus Christ. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Let us offer each other the sign of peace.
Forgive us the sins of the world.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those who are called to the supper of the Lamb. May the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ bring us to everlasting life.
Thank you.
Kingdom of heaven is available for you here and now, but the question is, are you available for the kingdom or not? Let us pray. Renewed by partaking of this divine gift, we pray, O Lord our God, that by the example of the blessed Saint Alphonsus, bearing in our body the death of Jesus, we may strive to hold fast to you alone. Through Christ our Lord. The Lord be with you. May Almighty God bless us, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Mass is ended. Go in the peace and love of Christ.